there ever been a time when you felt like you were unfairly treated in that you didn't receive as much as you thought you deserved based on what you see other people receiving, based on what they've done? See, we human beings, we have this really keen justice-o-meter in our nature, many of us at least, when it comes to comparing what we get with what others are receiving. And Jesus is really getting at that point here. So before we even dive into this parable, I think it's safe for us to start by saying, our Father in heaven is the most intelligent, most powerful, most all-loving being that we can imagine, and he knows how to give the right kind of gifts at the right time in the right proportion to the right people. We have to trust that. And so let's jump into the actual parable here. Verse 1. Oh, before we actually read verse 1, look at what preceded the parable. It was the story of the rich man who couldn't give everything up. And then this idea of verse 30, but many there are, first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Sometimes we think, hey, we deserve more and we're going to go first. And sometimes it's actually the last who get to go into the kingdom of heaven first. So that's kind of the key that Joseph Smith would say, look at what brought on the parable, look at the setting, and then you'll be able to interpret the parable better. Look at verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man that is an householder, which went out early in the morning to hire laborers into his vineyard. So common laborers would go to a designated location in the city or the village, waiting for the people to come and hire them. These would be temporary laborers, and they're waiting to be hired out. And if they don't get hired out, they're not going to be able to have the means to provide for themselves and their family that day. So it's early in the morning, verse 2. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, he sent them into his vineyard. So that is, one penny is the common price paid to a laborer for a full day's work.
It's a denarius.
It's one denarius. So there's this whole group that goes in to the vineyard and begins working. And then he went out about the third hour, and he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. They don't have work. It's the third hour of the day, and he goes and he agrees with them, and they went their way.
But he also does say, whatsoever is right, I will give you. He doesn't tell them how much he's going to pay them, which is very interesting, because we get in verse 2, the very first group, I am going to pay you the fair daily wage, which is a penny. Everybody knew it. It's one denarius. No questions. So here, these guys in verse 4, they realize that they probably don't deserve a denarius because it's not a full day's labor. And so when he says, I will give you whatever is right, they're agreeing to it. They realize there's probably going to be some kind of discount on our labor today.
That's right. Now, keep in mind, we're in many of our cultures today, in the modern world, we're used to working an eight-hour day. In antiquity, they would make hay while the sun shines. It's sun up to sun down. So approximately, depending on the time of year, sunrise somewhere in or around 6 a.m., that's your first group. And then that second group was in the third hour of the day. About the third hour. Well, 3 hours after sunrise is approximately 9 a.m. So then you pick up verse 5. Again, he went out about the sixth and ninth hour and did likewise. So the sixth hour of the day, this third group, is going to be at around 12 noon. And then the ninth hour of the day will be our fourth group, which would be 3 p.m. And you think we're done? No. He says, verse 6, and about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing idle and saith unto them, why stand ye here all the day idle? The 11th hour, this fifth group, you're talking 5 p.m. There's only one more hour to work in the day. before the 12th hour, before sunset. And notice their response. They say unto him, because no man hath hired us. We're standing idle because we can't hire ourselves. We can't go and force ourselves into a working agreement with anyone. We don't have that power. We have to sit back and wait for somebody to come and say, come labor in my vineyard. And so he said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive. I can picture these men in the 5 p.m. group thinking, yeah, there's 1 hour left. We might be able to get just a pittance of a denarius, of the pay, but it's better than nothing. And so they go and they work. Now, verse 8, so when even was come, when the evening, so the sun's ready to set here, the Lord of the vineyard saith unto his steward, call the laborers and give them their hire, beginning from the last unto the first. Remember what preceded this parable? Chapter 19, verse 30, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. So the steward calls this group now first. The last group now becomes the first to get called. And can you picture them all lining up in this queue, ready to receive their pay? And they're watching. And verse 9, when they came that were hired about the 11th hour, they received every man a penny. I don't know about you, but I can picture being some of these earlier groups looking at that thinking, oh, wow, he got a penny. And he did too, and he did. That group got one penny for 1 hour. Now, can you picture in the natural man's brain the math starting to kick into gear? Huh. So if he gets a penny, a full day's pay for 1 hour, then those of us who came at 3 p.m., we're going to get 3 pennies. And this group, they're thinking, we must be getting 6 pennies. This was a great day at the vineyard. And their expectation for reward is growing as you go up this list. Now watch what happens. Verse 10, but when the first came, they supposed that they should have received more, and they likewise received every man a penny. And when they had received it, they murmured against the good man of the house.
I like how it says the good man of the house. It's not just the guy who owns the land. He's a good man. He is just and righteous, and he is a man of his word. He has a very righteous agreement. I'm going to pay you guys a penny, and he fulfills the bargain.
And that's what they'd agreed to 12 hours before in the market, and they were happy about it then. But now they're not happy about it. Why? What's happened here? This brings us back to President Ezra Taft Benson's talk on pride. The problem with pride is it's rooted in this spirit of comparison. It's a spirit of I want more than what you have because I deserve it. I've earned it.
Yeah, it's such an interesting word. The root word for pride also comes from the same word for being first in front. And these guys are like, we should be the first. We should be out front. We're better than everybody else. And Jesus is like, you were first, but now you're last.
So Elder Jeffrey R. Holland gave a talk in General Conference many years ago using this parable as the foundation for his talk.
Yeah, it was April 2012. In my opinion, this is the best interpretation I have ever heard anywhere in this parable. I have spent a lot of time listening to lots of scholars on the scriptures, and Elder Holland's talk on this is the best one I have ever seen.
It's beautiful.
We follow living day prophets.
We thank thee, O God, for prophets, seers, and revelators. So let's dive in now to what is their complaint against the good man of the house, and what is his response? Verse 12, these men are saying to him, these last have wrought but 1 hour, and thou hast made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and the heat of the day. We have worked like crazy for 12 hours, and you're treating us the same. But he answered one of them and said, friend, I do thee no wrong. Didst not thou agree with me for a penny? Take that thine is and go thy way. I will give unto thee this last, even as unto thee. Is it not lawful for me to do what I will with mine own? Is thine eye evil because I am good? Brothers and sisters, the point is, Jesus was being, the good man of the house, was being merciful to these people who came. He came into the market at 6 a.m. and he gave them employment. They didn't have to spend all day wondering and worrying and fretting, stressing about if they're going to be able to provide for their family and for their needs. They were given an opportunity to work in the vineyard, and each group after that was given similar opportunities, and it was agreed, I'm going to give you, I'm going to be fair to you. But God's idea of fairness isn't always the same as the world's idea of fairness. And his point of, I know what I'm doing, and I know how to give my gifts to people, or the rewards to people. I'll never forget my wife's grandmother, Grandma Ruby. She was not a member of the church. She was in her late 80s. She was living with my mother and father-in-law, and we were visiting, doing a scripture study with the family, and Grandma Blackmore happened to be there participating, as she always did, and we were reading 2 Nephi 31, and it was talking about the baptism of Jesus. And here's Kipling's grandma who said, I've never been baptized the way Jesus was baptized. Is that something I need to do? And that opened up a whole conversation. And before you know it, she was taking missionary discussions and she got baptized. Late 80s, went to the temple a year later and passed away not long after that. And it would be easy for somebody born in the church to say, well, how fair is that? Is she going to be given celestial reward when she didn't serve in the church? She didn't pay tithing for all those years. She didn't go on a mission. She didn't do any of these things that I've been doing in the vineyard my whole life. How is it fair that she could get the same reward as I get? What a sad question to even ask, because what it's implying is, I want more exaltation. I want more celestial kingdom than somebody who gets baptized late in life or serves the Lord or engages in the gospel later in life than I engaged in the gospel. Brothers and sisters, that whole point is rooted in the idea that being in the gospel and being in the Lord's vineyard, doing the Lord's work, isn't pleasant, that it's miserable, and that I want to do as very little as possible and still receive the full reward, when in reality, the greatest joy in life comes to those who find joy in serving the Lord and serving others. Standing idle in the marketplace is not happiness. It's not peace. And thank heaven for a God who's willing to keep coming into the marketplace through the efforts of his missionaries and prophets, seers and revelators, and parents, and keep inviting people to come and labor in his vineyard and trust that he is a giver of all good gifts.
So let's continue on and hear the words of Elder Holland and his glorious interpretation of this parable.
It is against that reading of the story that I feel the grumbling of the first laborers must be seen. As the householder in the parable tells them, and I paraphrase really only slightly, my friends, I'm not being unfair to you. You agreed on the wage for the day, a good wage. You were very happy to get the work, and I'm very happy with the way you served. You're paid in full. Take your pay and enjoy the blessing. As for the others, surely I am free to do what I like with my own money. Then this piercing question, to anyone then or now who may need to hear it, Why should you be jealous? Because I choose to be kind. Brothers and sisters, there are going to be times in our lives when someone else gets an unexpected blessing or receives some special recognition. May I plead with us not to be hurt, and certainly not to feel envious when good fortune comes to another person. We are not diminished when someone else is added upon. We're not in a race against each other to see who's the wealthiest or the most talented or the most beautiful or even the most blessed. The race we are really in is the race against sin, and surely envy is one of the most universal of those. Furthermore, envy is a mistake that just keeps on giving. Obviously, we suffer a little when some misfortune befalls us, but envy requires us to suffer all good fortune that befalls everyone we know.